Good afternoon, colleagues. I want to greet the Deputy Vice Chancellors this evening, the Executive Deans of Faculty, particularly our Executive Dean of Science, Professor Azwindini Muronga, who is presiding over this session, the colleagues in the Faculty of Science, in the Department of Zoology in particular, and then science disciplines and beyond them, professors and all members of the Academy here in present, members of senior management that are here, students, honored guests, ladies and gentlemen, family members, friends and colleagues who are sharing this celebration with us on account of Professor Nel. I am pleased to welcome you all this evening on the occasion of the inaugural lecture of our colleague, Professor Ronel Nel. I particularly wish to acknowledge and welcome Professor Nel's family and extended family and friends, none of whom can be here today, but have always supported the professor from afar in all her endeavors. We share in your joy and pride on this special occasion as a family of Professor Nel. A special welcome also goes to Professor Nel's friends and colleagues in the Faculty of Science and in the zoology fraternity as a whole, who have journeyed with her, supported and encouraged her on the road to this high point in her career. It is indeed a cause for rejoicing this evening. Professor Nel would particularly wish that I acknowledge this evening her mentors, Anton McLachlan, George Branch, George Hughes, and Graham Kelly, for their professional and personal guidance and support over the span of her long career. We all know that the support of family, friends, and colleagues is at the core of our success as individuals. At times, our energies flag on our journey to success, and our loved ones, friends, and colleagues become our anchors, and they help us to refocus, to re-energize, to re-enthuse, and to persevere as we navigate turbulent waters of a lonely road to becoming a professor. Let me congratulate you, Professor, on your outstanding achievement. Being promoted to the level of a full professor is an affirmation of your accomplishments, both as an academic and a scholar. Ladies and gentlemen, it is always a matter of personal pride for me and pleasure when one of our own is acknowledged by their peers and the academic community, both locally and globally. Professor Nel has been with us since 2006, I'm informed, and has established herself as a scholar of global repute in her field. You have made your mark, Professor, at Nelson Mandela University, not only as a leader in your field of zoology, but also as an asset to our Faculty of Science, the Academy as a whole, and to the communities in whose name we exist. It is commendable that your research includes a focus on citizen science, since it is only through engaging with communities, as Professor Muronga always advises us, in equalizing partnerships, that we can make a real impact on addressing the intractable challenges of our time. The focus of your research, namely understanding why the leatherback sea turtle population nesting in the Isimangaliso Wetland Park in South Africa has not increased despite decades of protection. I had to practice this a lot, Ronel. This study, this work is, in my view, not only critical as a scientific endeavor, but also plays an important role in addressing itself to issues of global sustainability, which we are grappling with. Two decades of your research has shown that marine habitats are transformed through human activities, which may now be unsuitable to support larger populations under the current climate for these complex species. It is indeed a fitting example of how scientists in the ocean sciences domain are contributing to positioning this university as a leader in generating cutting-edge knowledge for a sustainable future. particularly in this very important differentiator field for us as a university. For this, I thank you, Professor, and I salute you. Professor Nel's research prowess is bolstered by a formidable teaching record, publications, and consulting record, as well as various forms of engaged scholarship. This is a testament to her enduring commitment to expanding her body of work in her field, while ensuring that this work finds practical expression and relevance to the measures required to protect endangered species on our planet from threat to their existence, such as climate change. We are indeed honored that at this point in your career, you are part of the Nelson Mandela University family. We are proud of your accomplishments, and we eagerly look forward to listening to your lecture this evening. When I arrived here at Nelson Mandela, you were a young scholar. So it has been quite a pleasure to watch you grow in the manner that you have done, Ronel, and so fast. Congratulations once again. I now am going to request the Executive Dean of Science, Professor Azwindi Nimuronga, to introduce Professor Nel to the congregation. Thank you very much, colleagues.
Good evening. It gives me pleasure to introduce our guest speaker this evening, Prof. Ronel Nel. Prof. Nel obtained her PhD from the University of Cape Town, 1996 to 2002, and since then she has been employed at this university from 2006 till present in the Department of Zoology and Faculty of Science. It is pleasing to note that she has been awarded numerous awards, few of them, the latest being the prestigious Pew Marine Fellowship from 2018 to 2022. She also has skills that this university needs, especially in the ocean sciences, a commercial diver class four, trained in all aspects of scuba diving, and she's also doing the training. So DVCRII, we have somebody who can train for the ocean sciences. She has been teaching from undergraduate all the way to postgraduate, including honors, various modules. And she has supervised quite a lot. She is currently supervising three PhD students. She has graduated to completion 7 students. She is currently supervising 3 students, masters, and she has graduated 17 master's students. And we have got other students beyond science in other qualifications that she does supervise. She has also supervised 2 completed postdoctoral fellows, and she has got 1 currently. She has been an external examiner for various universities in South Africa and as well as abroad. She has got more than 50 publications to date in high impact journals. She also have published in 4 book chapters, 7 in total technical reports, and 4 in total of popular articles, and she has organized quite a number of conferences and workshops nationally and internationally. She is also a member of various committees, including the member of advisory committee of the Indian Ocean, South African East Sea Turtle, and there is an MOU under Convention of Migratory Species. She is also a South African specialist on the Western Indian Ocean Marine Turtle Task Force. She's also a regional co-vice chair of the Western Indian Ocean Marine Turtle Specialist Group. She has done quite a while in resourcing funding to the tune of more than 5 million euros into her research projects. And ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, I would like to welcome Prof. Ronel Nel to deliver the lecture. Thank you.
Good evening, colleagues. Thanks so much for arriving at this evening. It's been a long time coming. As you can hear, there's been a lot of work that's happened to bring us to this point. It's actually quite difficult to reconcile the dirty, sandy, manky kind of turtle work that we do in the field with this very auspicious occasion and the very formal garb that we're wearing. I hope that I can live up to that occasion and tell you a nice story of the work that we've done up until this point. So most of you know about sea turtles, but I think very few people actually have experience with sea turtles, maybe in an aquarium, or maybe in a play park of some sort where there's a model, and then we think we know something about sea turtles. But it's not really the same until you get to walk the beaches at night and you see these beastly organisms coming out at sea, or you watch the dexterity with which this mother is digging a hole and very carefully dropping sea turtle eggs. And then months later, after watching carefully after that nest, you get to see them hatch, and you see the chaos, yet the vulnerability of how these individuals get down to shore. It really is something that if you haven't had the chance yet to experience, that you should commit yourself to doing. Just as a side question, how many of you have ever seen nesting turtle? My students are not allowed to answer. Okay. How many people know that we have nesting sea turtles in South Africa? Very few. It's only happening in the northeast corner of the country during summer months. So that's your chance. Go for a good summer holiday. And that really is where my journey started. This was the very first leatherback that I saw. Up until that point in time, I was used to looking at beach macrofauna, which means that you have to look through a microscope to see these critters. And I heard about turtles, and I was asked to take a bunch of international colleagues. And for nights, we were patrolling the beach, and I mean, without success. And then I thought, geez, but these guys are not doing it right. This is me never having seen a turtle. And anticipating that we're walking, and we're going to stumble over them, and never did we see anything. Until I saw this massive, what looked like tire tracks, like a bulldozer walking up the beach. And that was the first leatherback, and it basically transformed my career in that moment. Now, many of you have commented tonight that I'm not a small girl. Neither was she. She has got a shell length, only a shell length, of 1.8 meters. So these are large beasts. So when I started my career, I knew nothing about turtles, as I confessed. And more or less at the same time, this paper was published. And what it said was that Pacific leatherbacks were at the brink of extinction, and it was largely because we saw this decline in a population with an order of magnitude in one decade. We were looking at 1,300 females dropping down to only 100. And the prediction was, or the anticipation was, that it could be partly due to fisheries. And the prediction was that by now, this population will be near extinct. And the scientists were not wrong. That is exactly the case. In the last few years, we've seen no more than 30 individuals nesting on that beach. The good news is, though, that this is in the Eastern Pacific population, which is sitting on the Pacific side of Costa Rica,
our nesting population is way over there in the Indian Ocean side. So it didn't mean that our population was necessarily at the brink of extinction, but things were not looking good. The other question that we have to ask is, I mean, these beastly individuals come ashore, but where do they go when they leave the beach? And we didn't know much until this era of satellite tracking. So this is a picture of about 120 satellite tags that were deployed over time on Western Pacific leatherbacks. And it is clear that they make this 11,000 kilometer journey from the one corner of the globe right across the Pacific. Does anybody know how big the Pacific is? Huge. So they do that migration to get to a foraging ground. And in the process, they swim across waters of about 15 nations. It means that no single country can do the conservation on their own. And this is the first point that I want to make tonight, is that with marine migratory species, we really do need international collaboration. And that's where we sit around the table, even with people that we might be fighting on other fronts at the time. But the one commonality that we have is sea turtle conservation. And we can be inspired and we can be enthusiastic about the same things. So we need international collaboration. But I'm sure that most of the skeptics are saying that it's not only turtles that are fighting this fight. And it's true. There are a whole bunch of species that are doing these massive migrations, as you can see there. It includes things like sharks, marine mammals, fish, even squid and seabirds do it. But there is one very, very big difference. Sea turtles crawl out onto the beach, and here they become accessible to people. It doesn't matter on the color or creed or age or culture. Everybody gets inspired by sea turtles. That, of course, is great for them, but also great for us. It brings opportunities. And the kinds of opportunities that we talk about here are things such as learning about our evolutionary history. I mean, sea turtles have got many hard bones and a very hard shell, so they fossilized well. And they were around since before the dinosaurs. So they survived in the oceans when the dinosaurs couldn't. So we learn about what the past looked like. They're central to many, many cultures. I don't know how many of you know this, but there's a belief by the Iroquois people of North America that North America, or the world in their case, was founded on the back of a sea turtle. Of course, the Aboriginal people believe that the stars in the sky, particularly the constellation that makes out a great mother turtle, is guiding hatchlings home. So it's central to these ancient people to also engage in many social, cultural, and religious contexts. Of course, a no-brainer for us is that we are interested in the ecology and the biology, and we love to dive and work and study these turtles, but they are very difficult to study. For many of the island nations, this is the big five of their worlds. So many economic, tourism, and media opportunities, that's what broadcast their countries to the rest of the world. So it's economically central to their being. But because there's so much interest by people, we also have conservation and management challenges. And luckily in South Africa, that is not a problem. We do not see that kind of events happening because we've got a very well protected area. But it does bring around some study opportunities for us. And then lastly, because these are broad-ranging species, we can only effectively study them and manage them through international agreements or multilateral environmental agreements. So from a university perspective, what are the opportunities? I think Prof. Mironga summed it up very well in saying that there are three pillars that any university is about: teaching and learning, transformative engagement, research, innovation, and internationalization. And basically, those are the summary of what what has been happening in my career. Lots of students, we also included in the undergraduate curriculum, attracting international students to us, some here tonight, and then a large number of international meetings under the banner of NMU. Okay, that's the good news. Where are the challenges? Of course, it's not an easy feat to have to look after these strange organisms. As every South African, we should be proud to know that we've got one of the longest running conservation programs in the world on sea turtles, the longest running on leatherback turtles. And it started in 1963. So a lot of these accolades and awards that I so happily received must be realized that it was built on a very good foundation. I was not around in 63. My career started quite a bit later, but these pioneers basically provided us with, or provided me with a very good basis. So when I joined SMVelo KZN Wildlife, I finished my PhD and I then went into industry first. There should be a star there. That's more or less when I joined the program. And when I looked at these numbers, it didn't look so rosy to me that there was this massive increase in population abundance. So that's basically a population trends over time. The notion at the time, the best I could come up with, was that leatherback population is stable. And yes, loggerhead populations were increasing. So that really is where the start of my career has been. And I've spent 20 years since looking after that population along with the colleagues at SMVelo. And it has been a great honor, but also a great challenge. So the real stars of today's presentation are these two critters, the leatherback turtle and the loggerhead turtle, both of them nesting in the beaches of Isimangaliso in northern KwaZulu-Natal. It was only in 2010 that it was recognized as an independent management unit, which means that this is a population that's genetically isolated and they only come to nest in South African waters. We've got about 70% of the nesting, 30% we share with Mozambique. It's the only place on the planet where they come to nest. The question that I asked was, why is the leatherback population not increasing despite conservation? And that's the question that I would like to answer tonight. And if you get confused between leatherback and loggerhead, just remember this, if you can make it out for scale. Leatherback is the big black turtle, same size as me. Loggerhead, about half the size. That's me, again, wrestling a loggerhead, but it literally is half the size. So that's what we're going to compare. So my very first sabbatical, I went off to the University of Washington because I knew there were population modelers, South Africans, working there. And we did the first analysis of the data that we had. And the two models that we ran against each other, the one was based on nest counts, track counts. So it is a fairly robust index because turtles leave such a big track behind, you can't create or miss that. It's there. If you walk on the beach, you're going to see it. And the other one was based on a unique tag. Each turtle that comes ashore gets a flipper tag, or ideally gets a flipper tag. And these numbers confirmed what my suspicion was. So the leatherback numbers are not increasing as was advertised at the time, but the loggerhead numbers were. This was based on track counts. But the second model that we ran gave us a completely the opposite pattern. We saw that there was an increase in leatherbacks, but not in loggerheads. And this is baffling. Now, part of the explanation was that it's based on flipper tag counts, and if you don't see the flipper tag again, it either means that it got lost, or the turtle didn't come back to that beach, and then there's maybe an expansion of area. We don't have an answer yet to be able to distinguish these, but we have taken the first steps to clarify this. The first thing we did is every turtle now doesn't leave with one tag, but two tags. It gives us a 50% greater chance of seeing that particular individual again. But we also employed satellite tags. That means a turtle gets a tag in every movement that it makes thereafter. Every time that it surfaces, we know where it is, just about on the planet. And in this case, we used to look at just the internesting period. So from when it's on the beach to nest, gets a satellite tag, goes and do whatever turtles do in the water, and when they come up again, we can log that position. And for the loggerhead, the smaller turtle, it worked very well. This black line over here is the Isimangaliso Wetland Park. So we see that these turtles have got very high fidelity, and this is the monitoring area. So every time that a turtle came up, it was counted. This is not the case for leatherbacks. This is the monitoring area. Not only does it leave the waters of the park every time that it goes out, a lot of the nesting events are not counted by us because there's just no monitoring there. So Linda, my postdoc, which did the analysis of this, worked out that in this process, I don't know if you can read that, it says monitored and not monitored. For loggerheads, we only miss about 12% of the nesting events. But in leatherbacks, we've got a lot less confidence in the patterns that we see because 66% of the nesting events are not inside the monitoring area. So there's low confidence in what we say about population trends at this time. So, or rather say we have to be cautious. There were two very good outcomes, though, of this work. The first one was that Isimvelo KZN Wildlife employed more local people to assist with the monitoring. So we expanded the monitoring area for another 30 kilometers, including a partnership with one of the concession operators, which are driving that distance anyway. So easy, quick way to get more data. But the other part that's really important is everybody here knows that South Africa got more marine protected areas recently. And the massive expansion of the Isimangaliso Wetland Park, both south and out, was because of this data. So the park was largely proclaimed to cater for leatherback internesting movement. The question is, what does it mean for our understanding of these critters? And we had to go back to basics, and that really is looking at a basic population model. Now, everybody here has checked COVID statistics in the last while, so all of you know exactly what I mean when I say exponential growth in curves or flattening the curve. That's what's governed our lives in the last few months. The things that determined how fast those COVID spread was either virulence, so intrinsic growth or a species attribute, what the population size was, or in our case, how many people were infected already, and then the carrying capacity, herd immunity, I guess is the closest that we can talk about, what the environment can sustain. And what we would see is that there's an initial slow growth and then a very fast exponential growth until the population stabilizes around a theoretical point. And if there's a perturbation, number of individuals get knocked out, then that growth is not so fast and we basically get a slowing of that growth rate. But it's always to some point, some stable point, and that's how much the environment can carry. And that number can change depending on things like climate change or drought or whatever. So that is not necessarily always stable. So what we can see is that the specific attributes that affect that are things such as how many babies does the mother have, or how many eggs does a female turtle lay, and how long does it take for her to come back to replace herself, or does she get a chance to breed, which is the age to maturity. Or we're looking at extrinsic factors, which normally is how many of those babies will survive, or how many of those that grow to maturity die before they can contribute to the population. Now, normally, immigration would also be important in a turtle model, but because turtles come back to the same beach where they were born and only that beach, immigration is not important in this context. And then lastly, the effect of the habitat. And habitat's difficult to get a hold of, but it's basically how much space is there, what the quality of that habitat is, and what the climate is allowing to live in that habitat. And then, of course, we also have the anthropogenic threats that can affect both directly survivorship of individuals, or it is going to affect the habitat and in turn determine how many of those individuals will survive. So what I'm going to do is basically look at, in the rest of this talk, just visit those seven things in blue and see how well we are doing in South Africa. Okay. We start with fecundity. So that is, how many eggs does a mother female turtle lay, and how many of them will hatch and make it back to the sea? So again, the comparison between the smaller turtle and the larger turtle. And I know that there are a big bunch of numbers on there, but the ones in yellow are what you have to concentrate on. The first one being is the number of eggs per female. And my dedicated students here know that that can be a very messy job, because there are many of them that are now turtle doulas, lying with a hand and catching every turtle and counting the eggs. It's slimy and messy and whatever, but it's important work that needs to be done. So loggerheads lay about 10 eggs more per event than leatherbacks, which means that in this competition, they are winning. Then the question is, how many times do they come back? And that's where the larger turtles win, because they come back almost twice as many times as the smaller ones do. Then for emergence success means they come out of the egg, but they have to take about 5 days to dig their way out of the nest until they get to the surface. And there they sit and wait until the night when the temperature drops. And that's the cue that they have, that they can dig their way out and run down the beach. After that event has happened, we wait a few days and we go back and do what we call manky nests. We basically dig up whatever is dead in that nest and count how many of the hatchlings successfully made it down to the shore, how many of them arrested while they couldn't get out because it's a collective digging effort, how many of the eggs never developed and get rotten in the egg chamber, and of course, some of those never develop perfectly. And on the balance, loggerheads have a higher success, but because of the number of times that leatherbacks nest, the overall number of eggs per individual is about 140 odd more by these large turtles. So it seems like, if we base it on fecundity, that leatherbacks should win and should recover, but it's not the case. If we scale it up to the population, so fecundity per nest and then counting how many nests in the population, it seems like loggerheads had a better starting point. And initially they had about 100,000, got to 150,000, and probably sitting at about close to 250,000 every season now. But the leatherbacks, that entire graph can fit in underneath here. And we only have about 30,000 hatchlings being produced and getting into the ocean. I'm not even talking about dying in the ocean, it's just getting to the ocean, which is a small number because there are many threats out there. So individually, leatherbacks win, but on a population level, the smaller turtle wins. So the next factor that we look at is how quickly do they come back to breed? And does anybody here have any idea how long it takes for a turtle from when they were born till they come back? Okay, we'll see how good your guesses are. You can keep it in the back of your head. So again, those great people that came before me started an experiment. It's called the mutilation tagging experiment. And they took a leather punch and notched turtles with the individual year code. You can see this is what it looks like, and the code goes on. And they did this for 30 years. And more than 300,000 loggerhead turtles were notched. And they did this for 30 years, 10,000 every year. And I have to confess that this gold is the same cohort as me. We are equal in age when I sampled her. It is not quite the age to maturity, but what it works out to be is if we look at the youngest possible age for loggerheads, it's about 24 years. But with some tricky maths and forecasting, it's probably closer to 36 years before they come back to replace themselves. Okay, so if you think of this as the small one, any ideas what the big one's going to do? Ah, you didn't expect that. Okay, it's different. It's very difficult to estimate the age of leatherback turtles because these are oceanic migrants. You cannot rear them in captivity. So our estimates are very sparse. So what we're looking at here is something like 20 years at about 20 years before they come back. It means that loggerhead turtles, although they're being smaller, takes very long before they come to replace themselves. So if we sum up those three factors, leatherbacks win in terms of abundance or numbers. They replace themselves quickly, but the population is so small that we haven't gotten to that exponential stage, and it doesn't seem to get there, whereas loggerheads are definitely in the exponential phase. So what are these mortality factors that's stopping turtles from recovery? Okay, look down the throat of a turtle. It's not a pretty sight. They basically have these keratinized papillae, which is a fantastic adaptation that works for a life on jellyfish. So if you have to bite into jellyfish and you have to expel a whole lot of water, otherwise you're getting a mouthful of water with every bit of meal that you have, that works for you because it means that they cannot throw up, they cannot regurgitate at all. So whatever goes in must go out or through. And it works if your life is jellyfish. But we've transformed the oceans, and now there's a whole lot of plastic and plastic bags, and it can only go one way. So when these turtles bite into it, it has to go through the gut. So these are hatchling strandings that we've seen 2015, 2016. This is 1 or 2 years, and the first one is the 2014, the other one's 2015, and that's the small turtle and the big turtle. But we see these massive pulses. And this year is actually another one. I don't know if you saw the headlines. Just days ago, we had another 200 turtle hatchling stranding in Cape Town, of which most of them had plastic in the gut. And these plastics are hard plastics, so they break down and they puncture the insides of these hatchlings. Leatherbacks either are not suffering the same fate, which I cannot believe, or they don't make it onto land because the numbers are low. So maybe it's just a numbers game, but we don't know what that effect is. The next other bit of information where we can learn something is from a coastal fishery, and those being the Natal shark spawns or the bather protection nets. Now, this is not a CPUE curve, in other words, not for trend analysis, but what I want you to see out of this is, again, this is the loggerhead side, so the smaller one, and we have about 20 to 60 interactions every year. On the Natal coast, where these individuals are being caught in the shark nets. But the number for leatherbacks, which is the most reliable index of abundance we have, is sitting somewhere between 2 and 8 individuals for the most part. So it doesn't seem like it's that coastal fishery that's having an impact on leatherback abundance either. So we have to look beyond coastal waters. If we look at industrial fisheries. Now, this is a very complicated graph, and I'm not expecting you to understand it because I don't understand it. But what it does tell us is across this very large area, we've looked at the increase in the number of hooks being put out to catch fish, particularly tuna and swordfish. And over that time, it's increased quite significantly. But no such pattern is observed in either survivorship of the two species. It suggests that there's no explanatory power, or it's probably not because a direct effect of industrial fisheries either. So if you compare those numbers, where does it leave us? We have to look at, or most of the time in terms of conservation, particularly marine conservation, we look at drivers, or what are the production and what impacts it, and we want to stop there. But I think we have oversight if we don't look at the effect of habitat. So I went to the literature and see what we can learn from other species. And there are three examples that I want to mention here. The first one being the Mediterranean monk seal. And the monk seals were broadly distributed across the Mediterranean, as the name suggests. But they were hunted severely, up to the point where only two relict populations remained, one on an island in the Mediterranean and one outside on the African coast. That's, and they were using caves and very inaccessible beaches there. And it is because they could hide away in caves that they were not impacted on by people. The problem was the offspring would then die in caves. Even though they can swim underwater, they actually couldn't navigate out. And when the tide rises, they drown in these caves. So it's a suboptimal habitat for these moms to have their pups on. The story is not too dissimilar for the southern sea otter. So if you're looking at the Pacific Northwest coast, again, extensive harvesting by European hunters as they came in, numbers dwindled to about 2,000 left along the entire Pacific coast. And with the very complicated habitat of Alaska and Washington, there was enough habitat available for these otters to go and hide in. But a large estuarine system where there was a lot of sea urchins and a lot of abundance of food were turned into harbors. So, and the Californian coast is very straight. There's not nearly that kind of resolution. So they're not getting enough food, which means that the population is not recovering, despite the fact that they are protected species. And then the last one's my favorite, even though I don't routinely work on birds, but I do work on beach invertebrates. And this is a staging area, or the Delaware Bay is a staging area. So where they stop over for these sandpipers from their southern migration towards Canada where they breed. But these things over here are horseshoe crabs. And these birds stop to feed on the eggs of horseshoe crabs, which come onto the beaches in April to lay their eggs. However, those horseshoe crabs is basically what got us through the pandemic, because the blood of horseshoe crabs are milked and they are used in vaccines to say whether it's been spoiled or not. Last year, there was hardly any horseshoe crabs that came back to nest. I wonder why. And the population of this species has now dwindled. So that's an indirect effect of which a particular area has been affected, which really suggests that these are refugee species. And basically what the refugee species concept is saying, it's based on the Corley declining population paradigm. And it says that populations, even small ones, in stable habitats will survive. But the ones, even large populations, in highly fluctuating environments, stochastic environments that change unpredictably, or in suboptimal environments will decline, even if it's a large population. And we know climate change is a big multiplier on stochasticity of habitats at the moment. We can't really say, well, we've got examples of where species have been displaced, and we have examples now of degraded habitat. So it's possible that even marine species could be refugee species. Now, I have to step out here in the terrestrial environment for a moment. And this idea of a refugee species concept was coined by my esteemed colleague, and it was applied to a European bison. And this is the distribution of bison for a very long time, and basically the range contracted until there were only two relict populations. And like us, they were trying to recover these species with huge amount of effort for conservation, until it was realized that those two relict populations is not the ideal habitat, and we do it all the time now. We take present day distribution saying, oh, this is what the habitat is, what these species prefer. And those habitats were forested habitats. And that is the only place where the European aristocrats couldn't hunt these beasts because they could hide behind trees. They are really grassland species. And now that they've changed the regime, changed the habitat, conservation is successful. So maybe that is what we should do, or think at least about in the marine system. What I want you to remember here is basically three things, and that is the range contraction, in other words, species that have had a change in the distribution or a lesser habitat use, population decline, and habitat anomaly. And that basically brings me to the current research that we are doing. So my PEW project, which is why I've been going to the US and spending a huge amount of time doing data analysis, is to answer these three questions. Can marine species, so not terrestrial, those living on land, can those in the ocean, especially with such wide-ranging distribution, can they be refugee species? And would it be the same criteria that we apply? And particularly, we're using the South African population as a case study, and we're looking at two factors, because I've made the point already that we have a lack of recovery despite conservation. So we're looking for alternative distribution or habitat anomalies. Fortuitously, one of our colleagues stumbled on the bunch of animal tracks that have been fossilized for the last 100,000 years. But this isn't still by, so way down here on the south coast, so very far from current day turtle nesting areas. They sent me these tracks and asked me some questions, and the realization was that the tracks are very much the same sizes of the two species that we have in South Africa, but it's very far from where these turtles are currently nesting. So we can't say that it's the same species, but it does tell us that the climate was very different in not too long a distant past, and that the distribution could have looked very different for sea turtles. We've also gotten out of the European history statements like Delagoa Bay, there are large turtles found in the bay of good quality. So this is present-day Maputo Bay, and Rose Montero in 1891 reported on the large number of turtles and the good quality of turtles. And here we have Sydney Turner, which is a settler in KwaZulu-Natal, talking particularly about the Umzimkulu River, so way down south in KZN. And he said, we get lots of large turtles here in the net. We caught two very large ones the other night, the largest weighing, as near as we could guess, 500 weight. It means about 250 kilos. It took five of us to roll him up onto the boat. They are extraordinarily tough. They lie here in the garden, sometimes a month on their back without food and water, and seem to take no harm. The other day I fired a ball right through one, then tied a line to one onto its flippers and turned it into the river, and he lived for another 2 days. Okay, now we know why turtles become so scarce. And may I also comment on everything that we do goes through animal ethics and get suitable permits. That is not the practice that we have. But we have seen that there's been extensive harvesting, both European and traditional harvesting of turtles on our shores, and the populations have declined. This was a report made by Dr. George Hughes in the early 60s, which was the start of the turtle monitoring program. He also reported at the time that turtles were distributed all the way to Tanzania, which we don't see now anymore. If we do look at the current day loggerhead distribution, this is satellite tags, it tells us that they hug the coast when they leave the beach in Maputaland, going all the way to Beira, and that is their home, their feeding ground. We've redone it with counting our pennies in South Africa and done the same work, and out of these 24 turtles, 21 did exactly the same thing, moved from Maputaland to Beira, and that's the home. And these turtles are currently out at large with satellite tags on. And guess what? They do exactly the same thing. Two of them doing different things, but the others are going from Maputaland to Beira. That's the foraging ground. Leatherbacks are more interesting, though. The early satellite tagging that was done, they all left Maputaland and they went south and they rode in the current. And some of them stayed in the Indian Ocean and some of them went as far as Namibia. So we thought it's the same as that early picture where they go to the Californian coast to feed. So clearly, a student from the US, and we put on 16 different satellites of tags over two seasons. And guess what? They did the same as loggerheads, moved to Beira, or at least half of them did. So suddenly something changed, and it's either the distribution that has changed between then and now, or we didn't have enough replication. But what we see is that this area with that we share with our neighbors is a very important foraging area. Same thing. When we put our pennies together in South Africa, we did the same satellite tagging. And with the exception of a few individuals, it's very much that same behavior. And what we can see from the satellite tags is basically on the nesting grounds away, but stable isotopes, which is basically you are what you eat. And we can separate that these individuals, which basically went into the northern section with a red distribution, are coastal foragers. The diet is different to the individuals that went south. We get this big split. It means that they also come, when they arrive on our beaches, they come from these distant foraging grounds. And we get two very strong behaviors, basically what we call, Linda coined, coastal clingers and ocean rovers. And that behavior is inherent and it also persists in this internesting period. So for leatherbacks, we get two contrasting behaviors. And those turtles are currently out there. I check the satellite tags every morning, and it's very clear. Coastal clingers, ocean rovers. So leatherbacks have changed their behavior, which may be an adaptation, or we didn't capture it initially. Okay, so when we look at these, trying to explain what happens to individuals, especially for such broad-ranging species, where we have to maintain connectivity between the foraging areas or the nursery areas and the nesting beaches, which could be thousands of kilometers apart and decades isolated in time. It's very difficult to go and sample it. I will have to sample it now, and the next generation of scientists will get the results for many of these individuals. But what we also should recognize is that if any of those habitats get taken out, we may face rapid extinction of these populations, because it's the success of the population is only as strong as the lowest common denominator. And that's the problem with ocean migrants. So we can't do experiments on turtles. It's really hard. But what we can do is we can measure other indirect factors, such as body condition. So this last season, we took blood. And basically, very quick indicators is to look at the amount of protein in the blood. And these are reference values. And it tells us those are compared to other populations that are doing well. And in both instances, both of our populations are in good feeding conditions when they arrive. So it's not directly in terms of food. And the same in terms of the scale of dehydration to anemia. They fall in between these numbers, so they are in good condition. So the short-term indicators are they're in good condition, good health. Then we looked at the size, individual size. because that's an indication of long-term change. And we thought we're onto something. Loggerheads, both first-time nesters. So we could say, yes, it's a recovering population, so there would be more first-time nesters, and therefore we would expect the population to get small, or the individuals to get smaller. But we saw that both the experienced females that have nested many times before are also getting smaller over 30 years. In fact, they've declined by almost 4 centimeters, and that on a turtle is a lot. So we thought, okay, this is it. And guess what? The leatherbacks did the opposite. They are coming back bigger than what we had before. So leatherbacks are in very good condition. Doesn't matter whether they are first-time nesters or experienced breeders. So we're getting these opposite trends in terms of the individual size of turtles. So our small turtles are getting smaller, our big turtles are getting bigger. But the problem is, when we look at the individual size, and everybody here should appreciate it, big turtles have got, or big moms can have many more offspring, and they are good competitors. So it's good to see that in this relationship of the amount of eggs that a female lay increases, larger females lay more eggs, it holds. But then we looked at the individual egg size, and for loggerheads it works. Larger females also lay bigger eggs, but not for leatherbacks. So our leatherbacks, which are of the largest in the world, are laying some of the smallest eggs in the world. So if you can summarize those, our loggerheads, these are compared to international standards. It basically says loggerheads, they are small, but they lay average sizes of clutches and average eggs, whereas the leatherbacks are large individuals laying many eggs, but these are a bunch of small eggs. Now that's a problem, because the egg size will determine the offspring size, and the offspring size will depend on how fast they can crawl down the beach, and how fast they can swim, and how competitive they are. So that may be part of the explanation. One last factor to look at is climate. Now, sea turtles do not have genes that determine whether they are boys or girls. It's the sand, it's the incubation temperature that will determine whether they are a boy or a girl. And essentially, I always tell the students, chicks are hot and dudes are cool. So the cooler temperatures produce males, and the higher temperatures, females, which suggests that climate change in the short term may favor our populations, because we would expect more females, which can have more eggs. If we compare the curves, this is work with one of my students, and it's not a perfect experiment, but what we do see from this is that these curves are not equally flat. We actually start to get hatchling production for loggerheads or loggerhead females much at much cooler temperatures than what we do for leatherbacks. This is a very complicated situation, which I'm not going to talk about here, but what I want to do is rather jump to adult sizes or adult sex ratios. So these are individuals that make it that we can sample out at sea. And going back again to the coastal fishery in the bather protection net, those are the total number of male and female individuals caught for the small turtle and the large turtle over 40 years. And if we assume that 50-50 is a perfect ratio, it means that we get majority females, slightly biased towards females for loggerheads. But our leatherbacks have got about 2 males for every single female. So even though we are very much walking the beaches at night hoping to count turtles, males never come ashore. It's only females that crawl up to lay eggs. So all of our effort may be in vain, at least in terms of counting nests, females on the beach. So let's summarize. What this means is leatherbacks, individuals, very high reproductive output. They replace themselves quickly. Population is still too small to grow exponentially. We don't know what the sources of mortality are. It seems like there's an adaptation of behavior between clingers and rovers. The individuals are in good body condition. They grow very fast. They're growing very big, but they lay small eggs, which are also male biased. Loggerheads, not so much. Very large populations, so currently it's in their favor. Distribution is stable. The females are getting smaller, so it's something that we have to pay attention to in the future, because it means that they're going to lay fewer eggs, but it is female biased, so at least at this stage we get a large number of individuals coming ashore to lay eggs. So I'm begging for those that have not yet seen my application, I hope to go and do a sabbatical for the second half of the year to process some of this data. We have to look at the genetics, that is analyzing what we colloquially refer to as turtles before turtling. And it's essentially, is this a founder population or is it a population that was much bigger and we trimmed it down? And only the genetics can tell us that, as well as multiple paternity. So each of these females may mate with multiple individuals, males, especially if there's such a bias. And that will give us an idea how many dads are out there. We'll rerun the population model to be able to assess what really is happening. And then we will do some niche modeling and look at the other blood parameters, because maybe there are pollutants or other things that we can't pick up with these quick indicators that is suppressing turtle populations. Okay. So that is my story for the most part, and I have to say that I think I did a quick count. To put this data set together, it took something like about 100 odd volunteers over this time, and these are just my students. In my time, I'm not talking about all of the people that came before me. So it really takes a team effort to achieve this. But I also want to give special recognition to the guys in the local community that have to walk that beach twice a night. They walk it out and back, and by sunrise 6 hours later again to count all of the eggs. And if you put all of the distances together, each season to count turtles, those monitors walk around the earth once to count turtle nests. So it's a huge amount of effort. And I do have to recognize a colleague that has been the driving force from the Isimvelo side. We have spent many, many nights together on the beach, and Santosh Bashu needs a special shout out in this conversation. And then of course, funders, the NGOs that assist us, the Aquaria, and collaborating universities. And then in final conclusion is recognizing, just saying one thing about each of those academic heroes that Prof. Mutwa mentioned. And it really is to get an academic journey, particularly in the sciences, I think is a lonesome journey. I think many of the scientists here will agree with that. The family push from behind and provide the support, but there are always these guys in the front that just doesn't accept mediocrity and that pushing and the pulling and set the example. And the first one was Anton McLachlan. And I actually mentioned him because he was the head of department when I was still a school kid. And I came to the university to find out what the difference was between oceanography and marine biology, because I was yay size when I said, this is what I'm going to do. And the head of department spent an hour with my mom and myself explaining and talking. So eventually he became my PhD supervisor and is still a dear friend. But what it means, and that is to every head of department here that has interaction with prospective students, it matters. Every interaction matters, because that may be the next professor that you are working with. Graham was still Mr. Curly, I think you mentioned, when he was arrived back from Marion, long hair, and Graham was my lecturer in my first year and many years thereafter. And I mean, we loved to play jokes on the lecturers at the time, and we would push the boards way up high and then hide the stick to pull it down, and we thought it was really funny. And the advantage was Graham took it in good stride. But he always, when the science starts, he got serious. And you could see that a lot of the work that I'm still doing now is influenced by his guidance and his vision in terms of conservation. So I recognize your input, Graham. Thank you. I don't think that there are many marine scientists of my generation that cannot say that they've not been affected by George Branch or influenced by George Branch. I was a youngster. I was still in the bookshop for the university, or UPE, was still way down at the bottom of the Kral area. And I picked up this book that says Living Shores. And I couldn't believe that everything that I wondered about our shores, not an American textbook or anywhere else, it was talking about our shores. And I could read it and I could understand it, and it just opened up a world to me. And I met George for the first time because Anton invited him to a sandy beach weekend that we had, a working weekend, and George is a Rocky Shore person. And it was just so amazing how somebody was that knowledgeable about everything. And I'm not talking only about the marine stuff, it's certainly about the terrestrial stuff. Doesn't matter whether we were talking about a bird or a daisy or whatever, he knew about everything. A true naturalist that inspired many, many students. He's also the guy that I would phone up when things got tough and say, how do I go forward? And then, of course, George Hughes, the father of sea turtle conservation, and the person that introduced me to sea turtles, and ever the gentleman. I have to give credit to these guys. I have to thank them for their support, because it's been an incredible journey. But if you have these people to live up to, it really is a big motivating factor. Thank you to all for listening. It was a wonderful lecture. Thank you.
All I can say for starters is, wow. What a riveting inaugural lecture, Ronel. As Wendini, I've actually decided that every year we've got to have an update, because I'm going to be wondering now what's happening to the turtle population. So in that science engagement plan of yours, please put that. And kind of how I want to sum up in moving to the thanks part is, professors profess. That's why you become a professor. And you've professed in so many ways tonight. I was struck with how you started, with how your career journey started with stumbling, in a sense, on a beach and finding this turtle. And it's so important, in fact, that with our young people, as you mentioned, we actually share our career journeys. Because school kids get so uptight about how on earth do I find my career, etc. And many times, actually, the career finds us. You knew you had an area where you wanted to work in, but you didn't know where you wanted to specialize. And because of the learning and research experiences you were engaging in, it found you. So I think that's just such an important thing, in fact, to be professing. And in fact, what you've also professed is what zoologists do, because as I was sitting there, I thought, well, actually, I've never career counseled anybody and said, I think you should become a zoologist. And that would be because I actually didn't have a clue what zoologists do. And the way that you presented your lecture gave us such a wonderful picture, in fact, of this very exciting career. So I'm hoping this goes on the science website as a really good example of why we want more students in this area, for example. And it gives them such a brilliant idea of what they would be doing. And then, thank you, I'll get to that present soon. And then you also showed what scientists do. This meticulous systematic tracking, asking questions, finding answers you didn't expect it, and then going back and doing some more research, etc. So another good example of, you know, what professors do, for example. And then you also always refer to my students and I. It was very striking to me. And it just, again, that's a really good example for our students in terms of how, as you deepen your work and you get to postgrad studies, you have that closer working relationship with experts in the field. And sometimes, as you were saying, it's the student that found out a certain something, but you're able to build that into your body of knowledge. So really an excellent lecture with just so many examples of why professional is the right title for you to have. So now I need my glasses, otherwise I'm going to talk nonsense. I also need to say, and this was with a little present that came here, is that we've got a little message from the Alumni Association as well. Just as a reminder to you that they say congratulations on your inaugural lecture. The Alumni Association looks forward to your support and involvement in our activities to mark this very special occasion in your academic career and your time at Nelson Mandela University. The Association would like to present you with this symbolic gift and wish you well in your future activities. Thank you. We've already, when you closed off, you in fact thanked some of your mentors, and some are here today and some may have joined in, and other colleagues that you've worked with. I mean, your talk was also around the international collaboration, for example. And so we're very pleased with those who are joining us for the live streaming, as well as those who've been here tonight. Thank you very much. For the friends of the university, we're so thankful for the interest that you show by joining us for these special events. This was probably also our first inaugural lecture in COVID times that was properly hybrid. VC and I were talking earlier about, we did a few where there were four of us here and the person that was doing the inaugural, but this is the first one that's now properly hybrid. And thank you very much, therefore, to our team from academic administration and governance for organizing this event for us, and for our communications and marketing team as well. I know Chantal is here for the marketing that's gone with it, and I'm sure the marketing that will come out of this in terms of what can be shared with communities around what came out from your lecture this evening. And so in closing, again, as a good professor and a good lecturer, and you've certainly shown that you're not only a good researcher, but you're a good lecturer. We know that from your track record, but we know that from how we experienced this lecture this evening. And as a good lecturer, you've left us with questions. I've firstly got an image that I can't get out of my head. I'm trying to understand how a sea turtle could be bigger than me, much bigger than me, in fact. So that's gonna roll around in my head for a while. But the question I'm left with, other than wondering how the story unfolds, is why do they come back to their place of birth to nest? That's now a question I'm gonna have to engage with. So thank you very much for this presentation this evening. Thank you to everybody who's attended. I think we've all been enriched by it, and we wanna wish you very well with your ongoing research, and particularly all the students that are going to be working with you, and hopefully some more have been inspired this evening to do so. So thank you, one and all, and this now concludes this inaugural lecture. Thank you.